Good morning, this is Angela with Parker's Permaculture. I am doing a really important task in my front yard food forest garden here in Portland, Oregon this morning, and I wanted to share it with you all. So my husband is shoveling the rest of my compost for me while I get this job done, so there may be intermittent shoveling noise. I have many varieties of apples here in my orchard, and everybody knows if you grow apples, they can be fussy divas and prone to a lot of problems. We have historically in the last 100, 200 years selected for flavor and shape and texture of apples and not really disease resistance. Also modern apples are selected for shipability and their storage potential and also not necessarily for flavor, red delicious. And also not for disease resistance. And typically orchards in America spray the crap out of their apples. I don't spray anything, and I don't have apple scab here, and I amazingly have not gotten cedar apple rust on my property, probably because I feed my soil really well and I keep my apples strong and vigorous and better able to defend themselves against pests. I do have all old heirloom varieties of apple that I grafted myself from the home orchard education center, which used to be called the Home Orchard Society. And I have several favorites. Over the years, I have taken out a few of my apple trees as they have been disease prone or struggled with various issues, or as I just found that I have too many kinds of apples. Our family loves apples, we eat a ton of them, but I was growing too many kinds. I tend to overplant initially and then remove things and keep the few that are disease resistant and we enjoy eating and take up rest. So I'm doing this important apple chore here today, and that is protecting my apples from one of the few pests that they struggle with consistently year after year. Because I have selected heirloom varieties of apple for incredible flavor, storage potential, and because they are varieties that you cannot get in the store, unique varieties I can only get as a home orchardist, that doesn't mean these varieties were selected for resistance. One that I have here in my garden is the apple coddling moth. Now, for some reason, although coddling moths can infect quince, my quince trees have not had any trouble with it, my apples that are in the orchard areas where my chickens and ducks free range have very little coddling moth damage. It is mostly the apples here in my front yard and by my shed that are not part of the chicken run system that struggle with coddling moths. So maybe that is an encouragement to you all if you keep your chickens in your orchard. For me, I have witnessed over the last 10 years that they really suppress the coddling moth issue for the apple trees that are in their run. This apple tree back here that I'm going to be working on today to help protect from coddling moth is my Hudson's Golden Gem apple. My youngest son, George, this is his favorite apple. It is just, oh, if you have room for one kind of apple, a fresh eating apple, late ripening fresh eating apple, Hudson's Golden Gem is an oblong yellow apple, can be slightly russeted, that has a rich, creamy yellow, buttery flesh that is very crisp and very juicy. George is a smart kid. It is an excellent, excellent dessert, fresh eating apple. We eat all of them every year, and so I have not had the opportunity to try and cook with them because I have some other varieties that are better for cooking. So we only eat this one fresh, but when we do, oh man, it's so good, it's so good. Hudson's Golden Gem. So because it's in my front yard, it struggles with coddling moths, and I won't spray. I do a cardboard coddling moth trap around the bottom of the tree, but that has proved insufficient. And I've put out coddling moth traps and they are just kind of a pain in the butt. So this year I am trying something different. It is the most labor intensive method I have tried thus far. I've used it in the past, and that is bagging all of my apples. Now you can use like footy pantyhose, and I've done that in the past, but this year I ordered some specialty bags that I hope will last for years and years and years. They're a little bit tougher material, and if I'm gonna bag my apples, I want to be able to reuse the bags and not contribute waste every year from protecting my apples. So this is a method of bagging the apples when they're really young so that there is a physical barrier preventing the coddling moths from infecting the young fruit. And you need to do it when your apples are about between half an inch and 3/4 of an inch long, typically, is big enough to start bagging them. And like I said, you can use footies on pantyhose. Some people use specialty, like kind of waxed paper bags. I am trying these new transparent bags that allow good moisture in and out, but they are made from a plastic material, plastic mesh, and should last for many, many, many years. So I know, not ideal, they're plastic, but I mean, nylon pantyhose are also not recyclable. So I'm hoping these will have a longer life. I've read that they're good for up to 10 years of being out in the elements all season long, protecting your fruit. So while the permaculture solution would say be content with wormy apples and you know, don't put in the labor, save yourself that labor and just be content with wormy apples and work on finding a solution to have increased predation of coddling moths and lower the population in your garden, what I have found is this is not a part of my yard where I feasibly can work chickens and ducks into the design in my front yard with no fencing, and I'm not willing to put up fencing, and I'm not willing to take the time to put in temporary fencing and rotate my chickens through here. I have a lot of delicate things I don't want them to damage. So this labor-intensive method for me is gonna work because I am looking forward to having the Hudson's Golden Gem apples be just as worm-free as the Cox's Orange Pippin apples in the chicken run. That's what we want this year. So I'm gonna bag some of these apples and let me show you how I do it. So here's my Hudson's Golden Gem. I keep her pruned fairly short so she doesn't block my front window here. And you can see here, I've already started bagging. So unfortunately, to do this technique well, you have to reduce the number of apples set to one. Now, Hudson's Golden Gem doesn't do a great job of annual fruit drop on its own. I tend to need to come in here and thin the apples in June myself. So you want to thin them down to one to a cluster. So you do reduce the overall amount of fruit that you get from the tree, but it will all be very clean. Now, you also could buy the really big bags and bag two apples at once. I was not able to find an apple bag. These are not very stretchy. I was not able to find an apple bag that would accommodate two of these apples at maturity. These are very large. I mean, we're talking like very large apples at maturity. So if you have perhaps a more diminutive variety of apple, or you can find a larger bag, you don't have to thin them down to just one, but I'll be doing that. So this cluster of two, I'll take the smaller one. So here's another example. Here's a cluster where you can see this is definitely the apple that I want to keep. It's much larger than the other three. So because I can only keep one per cluster for this method, I'll remove these and bag this one. Now you can use twist ties. I've used those in the past, but these come with a drawstring on them. So I can just drawstring them up and tie them really tight. And that way the apple has room to grow and get sunlight and mature all on its own. And there is just a physical barrier between this lovely, delicious, little tasty apple and the coddling moth pest, which is so ubiquitous in North American apple orchards. So let me go ahead and step back a little bit and show you the context of this whole guild here. So persimmon, rhubarb, pawpaw, aronia berry, Hudson's Golden Gem, more rhubarb, Egyptian walking onions, Swiss chard, more natives in the back, and there's a comfrey behind this apple for chop and drop. I'm in here inspecting my tree, making sure everything is going well, and bagging the immature fruit. I also want to take the time to remove these water sprouts. When the tree is got all this flush of new growth in the spring, these water sprouts are vegetative and suck energy from the plant and get in the way, and I will need to prune them off with shears later, causing an open wound. But this time of year, you can actually come into your water sprout here so you can get a good look at it, and you can just snap it off with your fingers. and it comes off clean and it doesn't damage the plant. So this is a good time. As long as I'm bagging, I'm gonna open up my plant and get a little bit more air circulation. And I'm gonna take off all of these vegetative water sprouts here. That's it. And then these just get, not chop and drop, they get plucked and dropped onto the food forest floor where they will break down and return to the soil. We are done bagging this apple tree here. You can see I haven't bagged every single apple on the tree. I've bagged about 60 apples and I picked the biggest and best and most fully pollinated, so they are uniform, symmetrical looking of every cluster. And then I have thinned the apples and I've left quite a few unbagged. And that's because I am just balancing the amount of time and labor I'm willing to spend in order to get pristine fruit. And the ones that might have coddling moth damage because I didn't bag them, I'm okay with that, and I'm okay with eating them. We will use them either for making cider or just slicing and fresh eating. You can eat an apple with coddling moth damage. You just have to remove the worm and the frass in the middle of the apple. But I'm really happy with this so far. We will see how they do throughout the season, if they hold up and if they do a good job protecting, a better job than pantyhose. So thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up. Please consider subscribing and check out my Patreon in the description.